Hello, everybody, and welcome to our final webinar of the fourth year of the Period Posse Presents season. We're going to get started right away because we have a lot of content today. We have some fantastic speakers, and we want to make sure that there is adequate time for everybody. So today's webinar, as I'm sure all of you know, will be on puberty and menstrual health education, the role of teachers. As we've noted in the chat box, and Susie kindly put a message, this is Marnie Somer, by the way, if you could make sure that your chat box setting is to everyone, not to hosts and panelists, please let us know your name, what country you're dialing in from, perhaps the work you do if you're a student or you're working. We really like to know who is with us, and we like you to find each other in the chat box, connect, and be able to potentially work together or find common areas of interest. So looking forward to seeing in the chat box who is with us today. So just to continue, for those of you who may have missed last month's webinar, it is now up and recorded on our website, Period Posse Presents Recording. It was a terrific collection of folks who are working in the humanitarian space. So please be sure to check that out and share that in case you missed it. And also, I'm just seeing some people are putting in the Q&A box who they are and where they are, but if you could open the chat box instead of the Q&A box and share that information, that would be just great. You may have heard, but we have a global MOOC on menstruation. It has been around for the last year. We've had, I think, over 1,700 or 1,800 people take it. It is a free course. You can take it anytime you want. It is self-paced. We have speakers from around the world, case studies, lectures, activities, but we are offering a round of new scholarships for the $50 certificate verified track. So please check out the link in the chat box if you're interested in taking the course. And just an announcement for our colleagues at Susanna, they have just launched or will be launching this new research resource compilation. So please check it out. It has a wonderful array of content on all things menstrual health and hygiene. Great. And just to come back to our own webinar series, this has been the topics that we have covered in 2023. We are now on our final one again for the fourth year of the Period Posse Presents webinar. After this, we will be taking a break and starting up again after the summer months here in the US. So keep your eyes out for a new season ahead sometime in probably August. We will send out a reminder. Okay, so continuing on, and it's fantastic to see who's with us today, where you're dialing in from. Great to see people are changing the chat box to everyone instead of hosts and panelists, so we can be sure to see what time zones you all are in and what you are doing in the world of periods or education. So just as a sort of setting the stage for today's talk, this isn't something you all don't already know, I'm sure, if you're on with us, but we wanted to, oftentimes on this webinar series, we talk primarily about menstrual health and hygiene or about periods. And we're broadening that out a little bit today to talk about puberty education as something that may surface within health or sexuality curricula. It may be freestanding interventions. It may be something that young people learn about from home or from their friends or from their religious communities. So today, really, we'll talk about puberty education more broadly for girls and boys. But also, we will have some content on menstrual health education, which, of course, should begin during puberty, even though you may have menstrual health learning that is important to have throughout your life. And certainly as you start to manage your periods more regularly as your body is growing. And so both of those will be covered today. Sometimes people still ask me why talking about puberty is so important, or menstrual health for young age groups. And so what we like to remind people is that there's a lot of people around the world in this 10 to 14 age group, which is the easiest block of ages to find some numbers on. But also just to think about, pubertal onset does begin and often begins much younger. And so when we think about timing of interventions, we should really be thinking about those starting at 8 or 9 years old, and the enormous number of young people we're talking about in need of education and guidance. Just to flag, and I think probably this data is even limited in terms of what's available and what countries report, that there really is quite a low inclusion of curricula related to puberty in primary education. Oftentimes it's either not covered or it's covered later when kids have already gone through puberty. And even though it says almost 40% cover puberty extensively, I'm going to make a guess that that may mean more about the biology of puberty and human development and less about the practical changes and emotional changes and things that kids struggle with. So we're going to talk today about how we can do a better job on delivering it. I won't read this quote, but there was a paper from a few years ago, and one of the main things, it was a review piece on puberty education, and importantly, what it highlighted from that final sentence is that evaluations of classroom-based puberty education are quite rare. And that in turn led us to do what was a very small study with our wonderful colleagues in Sierra Leone. We partnered with CODE, the NGO, and a colleague at the University of Sierra Leone. We had developed puberty books with CODE in Sierra Leone, and their partnership with the government enabled us to then develop a teacher's guide that was distributed with the books to get a sense of if having a teacher's guide would encourage teachers to teach puberty education, even though it's not was not part of the sort of curriculum they were used to teaching. I won't spend a lot of time on this because I want to move to our speakers, but just to say that CODE sent, as part of their program, 260 schools copies of the book along with the teacher training guide, and they also sent the books to teacher training institutes. They also, along with a teacher training NGO, delivered in-service training for teachers who were going to receive the book. And then we went and did a feasibility and acceptability study of the teacher training guide. And Fran Vavris, who's our discussant today, was an advisor on this project. I won't read it, but as you can see on the right, we then did a series of key informant interviews with national government, key stakeholders, teacher training institute professors. We did in-depth interviews and focus groups with the teachers who use the training guide in the books, along with the kids, the girls and boys who received the book, to understand how that went. And we are working on a paper to submit, so I won't spend a lot of time on this. It will be out there eventually. But just to say that teachers really wanted more training around how to deliver puberty content. Some of them were hesitant, and they liked the idea of puberty content integrating into their existing curriculum. The students had a really strong desire to learn about both girls' and boys' experiences. The gender and age of the teacher influenced their comfort level, and they really liked when they were allowed to take the book home and share it with family members, which we were really delighted the teachers did in Sierra Leone. There's obviously a lot of social and cultural influences that impact teacher comfort, so that's something important to consider when thinking about delivering this content. And thus, it is also very important to involve parents, caregivers, and community. And then finally, not surprisingly, there were structural barriers and opportunities related to the delivery of puberty content, including teacher retention, sustainability of it, continuing beyond this program, and what would happen and if they were able to add puberty to the national curriculum and all those related aspects. So I won't spend more time on this. There will be a paper, but we just wanted to flag this work so people would know it had happened. And just fantastic to see, I'm just scrolling through the chat box at the same time that I'm talking, who's with us. Just a quick quote to wrap up the Sierra Leone and move on to our speakers. I really like the guide that I received in the training. It has really helped to break the silence about these topics between the pupils and the teachers. So that was from one of the clubs that used the book in a school in Freetown. So just one quote to kind of set us off to our speakers, thinking about how children, as I know everyone on this call probably already thinks about, are an enormous part of our population and our future. And so making sure they get the support and information and guidance they need is really essential. Okay, so as we launch into our speakers, please engage with the chat box, which you're all doing, which is fantastic. And everybody's remembering to change the chat box to everyone from hosts and panelists. So it's fun to see who's with us. Please open the Q&A box as well. That is where you will put your questions. And our speakers today will be following the Q&A box and responding to your questions. Susie has just put in the chat box. If you want to tweet about this and help people to think about periods, please see the QR code or the hashtag and information she's placed there. And she also put in where you can find the Sierra Leone puberty books if you're interested. To their PDF files are there. We will have a Q&A session hopefully at the end if we state a time, which we're excited. So again, please don't feel shy about asking your questions. We have fantastic speakers today, one dialing in from Bangladesh, another from Pakistan, one in New York, and then our discussant, Dr. Fran Favres, is in Minnesota. So we will start with our wonderful speaker dialing in from Bangladesh. We actually pre-recorded the two speakers, just we were a little uncertain if connectivity would be an issue. So I'm gonna play the recording for the next two, but they are online. They're available to answer questions in the Q&A box. And then they will also be available for the Q&A session at the end. So please let me know if you have any challenges hearing.
Hi, I'm Dr. Tishan Mahfuz. I'm working as a research investigator at ISADDRB. The title of my presentation is Teacher's Perspective on the Implementation of Menstrual Hygiene Management and Puberty Education in a Pilot Study in Bangladeshi Schools. To give a little bit about the background of Bangladesh, it is a densely populated nation situated in South Asia. There are about 169 million people living in less than 150,000 square kilometers, and majority of the population in Bangladesh are Muslims. Muslim population generally have limited open discussion about menstruation, which leave girls unprepared for the physical and psychological transformation of puberty and menstruation. We have known from previous studies that girls with no previous knowledge have negative perception of menstruation, and lack of support from school environment can contribute to school dropouts, which can lead to an array of negative impacts on girls. Schools usually play a vital role in the dissemination of health-related information. And the school teachers' training, involvement, and participation is also vital to the sustained programs and activities related to menstrual hygiene management. For a bit about the methods of what we had done, we had selected four urban and four rural schools and from near Dhaka, Dhaka division, which is, if I can go back to the slides, it's the orange area right there. And from there, we had selected Dhaka as the urban schools and the area right adjacent to Dhaka, known as Manikganj, as the rural schools. The target population were children aged from 10 to 16 years of age, or secondary schools, as we call it. And the study period was 2 years, and it was funded by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So this particular paper is about the teacher's perspective, but it is important to understand the pilot study that we had conducted. So the pilot study provided the girls with MHM products, facilities upgrade where it was required, such as fixing the toilet facilities, fixing the lights and the lock systems, etc. We had trained the teachers based on the MHM materials that we had developed. We had developed the behavior change communication materials, and we had formed gender clubs and MHM working group. I will go more into details about the MHM working groups in later slides. The MHM working group actually consisted of stakeholders from the Ministry of Education, Health and Family Welfare, and development partners and NGOs. One of the intervention components in the study was development of the education curriculum. We had designed the curriculum following a formative study with the students and teachers, and an intervention development workshop with the government and relevant non-government stakeholders. The curriculum for both girls and boys covered the physical and mental and emotional changes during puberty, male and female reproductive systems, menstruation, menstrual hygiene management, and overcoming menstrual stigma, nutrition, and additionally, the girls received a separate session on practical methods of managing menstruation and menstrual symptoms. Let me show you some of the intervention that we had developed. The photos included the teacher's manual that's in the photo, in the picture right in the on your right. And we had developed a slide or a flip chart for the students to have in their hand while the teachers were delivering the sessions. Another component of the education curriculum was teachers' training on the curriculum that we had developed. The head teacher of the four intervention schools nominated the male and female teachers. A total of 20 teachers, out of which 11 were female and 9 were male, participated in the study. The training was conducted in two phases. So initially we had a two-day training and followed by another two-day of refresher training in the middle of the intervention. And the training materials and the module was modified during the training based on the feedback. The findings from the SBCC sessions. Now, generally, the teachers reported a very positive change in the school environment and in the girls' behaviors. And they have also reported that they spoke to the guardians of the girls, and the guardians also had reported positive changes in their daughters. So one of the female teachers reported to us that one of the guardians had come to her and said that, "I have never asked my daughter about these, and she's in class 6, but now I can feel the change. Now she openly spreads and dries her menstrual cloth, and if she did not attend the classes, she would do it secretly." I want to draw your attention to the photograph that is actually in the slide. This photograph is particularly important because of the stigma, the menstrual products are kept in a hidden and a very dark and usually damp places. But after the intervention, we had visited the girls' homes and we noticed that the menstrual pack that we had provided, which is circled in the rack that she has, is actually with the rack that contains her books and her daily materials, such as her shampoos and lotions and such. So which is a very positive change for us, that she was able to overcome the stigma and keep the menstrual materials in the open. Another finding that we had noticed was the challenges for the teachers to deliver the contents. So one of the challenges that they had reported was time management to conduct the sessions. Because these sessions are actually extracurricular, these are not included in the regular teaching materials that the teachers are supposed to provide and which the students are evaluated on. Now, it is also important to understand that the examinations and the evaluations that of the different subjects that the teachers have to teach are actually, they contribute to the ranking of the schools in the school system. So therefore, the teachers usually spend more time in delivering the contents or teaching the students about the things that they will be evaluated on in the future or during the end of the school year. Because of the sheer number of students, one of the classes had actually about 40 to 45 students per class. The games and the interactive materials that we had included in the teaching curriculum actually were not done. And the teachers also have informed us that they are assigned multiple tasks aside from their teaching duties. So because these teachers are included in the government system, they have to take part in the other civic duty assignments, such as being a guard on other exams, and during elections, they have to take part in the election duties. So therefore, the time is a much of a constraint for the teachers. And also one of the things the teachers had reported to us is that these materials should be incorporated into the national education curriculum, in which way they would be forced to, or they would be asked to take out the time to teach these materials, and which is normally very difficult for them to do during the school hours. So one of the quotations is, if this topic is included in the existing curriculum for evaluations of in the national exams, it will be good. We have scheduled class routines and we had to manage extra time to conduct these extracurricular classes. So as a takeaway for the education practitioners that we found in the study, the teachers found that these teachings of the MHM contents were valuable and the materials are useful to the students, and they felt that it was important to continue providing such contents to the future cohort of students. The teachers also faced a constraint with their lack of knowledge on the topics before they went into this intervention. So it is also important that they have provided us this input, that it is important for us to sensitize the teachers in providing sensitive materials such as menstrual hygiene management and puberty, and to empower the teachers with this knowledge before they get into providing the sessions to the students. So another takeaway for the policymakers, we had had several meetings with the policymakers, starting from the Ministry of Education with the different levels of stakeholders. And the recommendation that we had derived from both this particular study, from the teachers and the stakeholders, are that we need to revise the current national curriculum to incorporate more in-depth materials and more practical materials of menstrual hygiene management and puberty. We need to provide the teachers with adequate training and support to deliver the contents. And also we need to incorporate the puberty and menstruation contents to the students' national examinations. So once they're evaluated, they will be able to, they will be sort of forced to teach these contents to the students. So that is all for my presentation. Thank you.
That was just fantastic. That was just a phenomenal presentation. Thank you so much. And I hope folks, I certainly have questions and comments. Please, everyone who's with us, which has been really fun to watch the chat box. We really have people from all over the world today. Please be sure to open the Q&A box and put in any questions you have for our speakers. And we will bring those out at the end during the Q&A as well, if we don't have time to get through them. But that was just wonderful. Also, I noticed that one or two people were dropping their email into the chat box. We really want the Period Posse webinars to be a networking, a platform for you all to find each other's. So please don't hesitate to connect with others you see from your country or who are working in areas that sound similar to what you're doing. We really hope that you'll find each other in our chat box while we listen to the speakers. Okay, so now we are moving along to have another wonderful speaker, Sheena Hadi from Pakistan. And here we go.
Thank you for having me speak with you today. My name is Sheena Hadi, and I am the executive director of AHANG, which is a local NGO based in Karachi, Pakistan. AHANG has spent nearly 30 years working on improving the sexual and reproductive health of individuals in the country. And one key area of work has been investing a great deal of time and attention in life skills-based education programs. And one important part of that has been on menstrual health education. So I'm here to just provide you a quick snapshot of some of our program's key learnings. I think when we talk about period poverty, we think about access to resources, and that's critical. But in Pakistan and many other parts of the world, the more critical area to start programming with is really looking at social aspects of period poverty. This involves the systematic way in which menstruation and those that menstruate are culturally and religiously stigmatized against. Girls from a very young age are made to feel shame about their bodies and the natural process of menstruating. It's associated with fear, impurity, and negativity. It also carries a really heavy burden for girls who are suddenly deemed to be mature, and therefore their sexuality is heavily guarded to secure the family's honor. This starts to bring into conversations around marriage, dropping out of school, their mobility is quickly shut down, and social access to peers and services with that. And because of the level of social stigma, most girls aren't given timely information. So less than 50% know about periods before they start, which obviously in and of itself brings a great deal of fear with it as well. So to address the social stigma and in turn to create a greater demand for products and facilities, AHANG started to work on school-based programs about 20 years ago. The program consists of a gender transformative life skills-based education curriculum in which sexual and reproductive health is approached holistically, and puberty and menstrual health, of course, plays a big role. One of the key strategies of the curriculum is not only to deliver information, but to build confidence and agency in girls to speak, negotiate, ask for help, and express their beliefs. The main delivery agents of the curriculum are teachers who are selected based on their expression of interest, along with the selection criteria used by AHANG's trainers to ensure that they have strong communication skills and would make a good point person for the curriculum delivery. Since the manner of delivery of content is often as important as the content itself, we've designed it to be interactive. There's a number of visual supporting resources and even some technology where it's accessible. And this really helps the students to be able to digest the material and for the teachers to navigate some of the trickier scientific parts of discussing menstrual health. We also use an ecosystem model. So we get parents and administrators involved and sensitized, and they become better advocates for resources and for supporting girls when required. To build an external referral system, we also involve the healthcare community, and we train healthcare providers who usually have a number of myths and misconceptions they hold of their own. And most critically, the programming starts really early, well before puberty. And this is because the earlier we start talking about the body in a positive way, the greater chance of building more bodily autonomy and preventing mistreatment and violence later on. So what needs to be considered to achieve impact? And there are three really critical things that we've noted. We found that the investment in teachers needs to be very substantial. So teachers are a product of their social environment, and there needs to be a lot of time and patience put into deconstructing the negative attitudes that they have towards gender, sexuality, and menstruation before they can be positive implementers. And we found that they also need a lot of refreshers, and they need ongoing dialogue to manage the challenges that do come up in the classroom. In some cases when programming has gone through several cycles and become sustainable, teachers themselves have come back and asked for additional skills, like counseling, for example. And we have to remember teachers are very overburdened. So to ask them to take on more means we need to be willing to support them in the long run if we expect programs to be sustainable and have impact. We've also found that the teaching modules need to be culturally relevant. By this, I mean that there needs to be a recognition of what approaches to menstrual care will make girls comfortable and what sorts of resources are more sustainable. In many cases, we've seen programs for single-use products, for example, pushed in communities, which are not well received, and they actually bring on greater feelings of shame and stigma amongst girls. So a great deal of care, therefore, needs to be taken in understanding context and supporting girls in what they need versus what we think they need. And finally, a really critical part of framing is to use rights as a key part of teaching modules. We've found that discussions on health alone do not work as well to trump social norms, as when girls are made more aware of their rights and better understand that menstrual health is a fundamental right that should be fulfilled. So thank you for your time, and I look forward to any questions at the end.
Another fantastic talk. It was just fantastic. And what was so wonderful is this combination of speakers we have, you know, hearing about both of them speaking to the challenges of that teachers face structurally and their discomfort. I think we oftentimes think, oh, we can just give this to the teachers and it'll be, we can just get them to take it on, things will be solved. But in fact, obviously it's a bit more tricky than that, but both talks are making me feel very excited about the possibility of what can happen with teachers if we commit to devoting the sort of resources and support that they need. So I'm going to actually exit my slides and invite, actually maybe I won't exit my slides, but hold on, let me just stop share and then invite Antra from the UN Girls Education Initiative to speak with us and give us a global perspective on these issues.
Thank you so much, Marnie, and thank you for having me here. It was wonderful to hear the perspectives of the colleagues who spoke before me. And I'm very happy that we had colleagues from South Asia, which has a lot of stigma around menstruation and puberty. And so we need a lot of colleagues like Tishan and Sheena working in that region. There are two points I want to make today. One is that if we talk about menstruation and puberty without linking it to harmful gender norms, without linking it to girls' empowerment, without linking it to progressing gender equality, we are not doing our job. And two, women teachers are also people who have gone through their own lives, their own trauma, their own gendered histories. And we need to, building on what Tishan and Sheena said, we need to see them not just as persons through whom we achieve what we want to achieve, but as people who can have exponential impact if they're supported in the right way. And I'm going to share a very, very quick and small story from the state of Rajasthan in India. Rajasthan has, along with many other parts of India, some pretty dire indicators on agenda. For example, 6 out of every 100 girls are not even allowed to be born. They are aborted in sex selective abortions. The rate of child marriage is 25%. And the rate of women's participation in the workforce is 17% compared to 62% for men. So a lot needs to be done. In 2018, I visited 2 schools, both of which were very remote, both of which were in the desert, first-time learners in both schools, 1 woman teacher out of 15 teachers in both schools. In one school, and in Rajasthan, you have to give out free pads, sanitary napkins in schools. In one school, sort of followed a similar approach. The woman teacher, who by the way was a math teacher, would sort of have the key to a cupboard in a dusty hallway, unlit. And the girl would sort of go up to her and whisper that she needed it. And then she would take the girl there, wrap it in newspaper, which again, she was doing on her own initiative, and give it to the girl. In the other school, the teacher, who was a geography teacher, had instituted a box wrapped in, you know, colorful gift wrapping paper in the school courtyard under a banner written in children's handwriting in Hindi, which said, menstruation is a human right. Boys were playing nearby. And girls could just go and take a pad when they needed it. And you could see a difference in the quality of the walk of the girls in the second school. They walked a little bit more confidently. There were a few more conversations taking place between the girls and the boys. So, and the other point I want to make here is that in both schools, there were way more girls than boys, which sounds counterintuitive in a state that has so much patriarchy, but it's not when you realize that the boys were being supported to go to private residential schools, boarding schools in nearby towns and cities. So what this teacher did when I spoke to her, she said, look, puberty was traumatic for me. I was not allowed to sleep in my bed. I was not allowed to eat with my family. I was not allowed to use the family bathroom. So she had to go somewhere else just to use the facilities. And she was determined that this was not going to happen to children that she was teaching. She was also supported by a local NGO with curriculum and with curricula and training and so on and so forth. But I think the difference between the two women, both of whom were doing their best, but the difference was this woman linked what happened to her to a desire to help girls and boys live out a different adolescence. So that is really the opportunity for us to not just look at women teachers as vectors, but as human beings who also have this potential for exponential impact. That's not just about knowing about menstruation and knowing how to manage menstruation, but knowing about rights and how puberty is actually the onset of very differing pathways to fulfilling rights for girls and boys. I'm going to stop there and turn it back to you, Marnie. Thank you so much for having me.
Of course, wonderful. And I think having these stories and these perspectives of the teachers is really essential. I could not agree more. And I think one of the things I've noticed for years working in this space is that we talk a lot, we have for 15 years, talk about menstruation and what girls need, and we don't think about the female teachers who also menstruate and have their own needs. They definitely get left out. So that's something that also, you know, I know as a researcher, we need to pay more attention to. So I'm not going to go back to the slides. I'm just going to invite Dr. Fran Vavris from the University of Minnesota to who is our discussant today. And you have plenty of time. We're great on time. So please don't hold back.
Thank you very much, Marnie. And thanks to all of the speakers. This has been such a rich discussion, and I look forward to the Q&A that will follow my remarks. My perspective on this comes from 3 sorts of experiences. First, I've been a teacher and teacher educator for many years, both in the United States and in East Africa, specifically in Tanzania. I've also been a researcher, and I'm a professor at the University of Minnesota, so I work in the area of gender, health, and education policy, and I've had many master's and doctoral students working on topics related to puberty and menstrual health education. And finally, I'm a member of the joint ILO-UNESCO so-called Committee of Experts on the recommendations concerning the status of teachers and higher education teaching personnel. And these are the 2 UN documents that talk about the rights of K-12 teachers and university level teachers. And I will put the links to those in the chat box, because the speakers today have talked about education as a right, but also the rights of teachers, and thinking about that link between education for children and the right to high quality teaching. So we do have documents that help support that. My comments are going to be at three different levels. The speakers talked about issues related to what I might call the macro level of teaching, so the schools and the classroom, the meso level, which would be the national level with policy making, curriculum development, teacher training, and then a global perspective. So let me just make a few comments about each of those from this perspective as a teacher, educator, researcher, and member of the this committee that monitors the rights of teachers and higher education teaching personnel. One of the most important issues, I think, that came out regarding the practice of teaching is sometimes called pedagogical content knowledge, or PCK. So not only do teachers need to be experts in the area in which they teach, whether it's mathematics or health, biology, so forth, but it's especially important for them to have an array of methods for teaching that content in a way that will be effective for the students in their particular context. I think Sheena said something about how the way that content is presented is as important as the content itself. And research on teacher education would back that up. We saw in the context of Bangladesh that some of the teachers did not use the games and interactive materials that they were presented with and encouraged to use, and there are a variety of reasons for that. There are also certain methods that teachers have seen as students themselves, particularly teacher-centered methods, lecturing, that are more familiar. So it is going to take a longer period of time for teachers to learn how to use more interactive and empowering student-centered methods. Also, we saw in the presentations about Bangladesh and Pakistan that there is a very important cultural context in implementing pedagogical content knowledge. In the case of Bangladesh, we heard the teachers also have duties during election times. There's also, not only in Bangladesh and Pakistan, but I would say around the world, a degree of social stigma in talking about menstruation and other aspects of puberty. So teachers not only have to have content knowledge about puberty and menstruation, but also the ability to convey this knowledge in a way that is culturally and contextually appropriate. At this meso level of national policy and curriculum development, we heard a great deal about this, and some of the areas that stood out to me have to do with the importance of basing curriculum development on studies of teachers and students. Curriculum developers are sometimes quite divorced from the classroom. They may have been teachers at one point, but they haven't been in the classroom for a period of time. So how do we bring the perspectives of students and especially teachers into curriculum development? There's also then the critical area of teacher training, or I prefer the term teacher education. So we heard about it, very important refresher courses or you know, in-service teacher professional development. But I want us to think also about pre-service. How can we work with teacher training institutions, teachers' colleges, so that the instructors, lecturers in those teacher training colleges are demonstrating and encouraging future teachers to use very interactive methods and to become more comfortable talking about puberty and menstrual health in any subject in which they might be teaching. And at this meso level, then, we see the very important issue of policy. And in policy, I'm also including examinations. Several of our presenters spoke about that. And there's a phrase that we measure what we treasure. Well, one way of measuring what we treasure is what goes on the national exam. So whether we support that kind of approach or not, it is the case that teachers are under a lot of pressure to teach to the national examinations, because these are the ways that students move from one level in the education system to the next. So what would it look like to seriously include puberty education, menstrual health education in the national exams? Not only, let's say, in biology classes, but classes where civics and human rights and gender rights may be discussed as well. Those are very important areas. I also want to emphasize, based on the ILO UNESCO recommendations concerning the status of teachers, that teachers have the right to be at the policymaking table. They need to be there. Their views are so critically important to the success of a policy. At the national level, we can come with all kinds of policies, but teachers are the ones who actually implement them in the classroom, and they need to buy into those policies. Finally, then, this global level that we've just heard about with the perspective from Ungai and from our other speakers today. Menstrual health and puberty education ought to be seen, ought to be treated as human rights, just as the right to education is. I think that we need to do a better job, and we can all become advocates of thinking about the right to education as also the right to high quality teacher education, so that teachers, the most important in school element of educational success, are as well prepared as possible. I would also like to suggest that we think about the provision of menstrual health products in the same way that we think about access to and provision of textbooks, chalk, other kinds of teaching and learning materials. We see that in some of the macro level global education policy discussions, those kinds of teaching and learning materials. But I have yet to see the same emphasis on menstrual hygiene products as we place on other teaching and learning materials. So those are some of the areas that I think our presenters today emphasized and vividly illustrated. And I hope we can have a discussion of these micro, meso, and macro level points regarding policy and practice with teachers. Thank you.
Fantastic. That was a wonderful set of remarks. Thank you so much. And what I'd like to do now, I see lots of questions in the Q&A box, but I hope people will continue to drop your questions into the Q&A box. I'd like to invite all of our speakers to turn on their videos now, and we will move into the Q&A portion of this webinar. We have time. So if everyone will come back, terrific. So I see that Rosette posed a question, which Tishan kindly already responded, and also to Paula's question. I may come back to those in case folks, so Rosette had asked, are there efforts to integrate puberty education and menstrual health into the teacher training curriculum so that teachers can have a dose of this content before they're churned out? So actually, I might invite both, I know Tishan, you already wrote an answer to Rosette, but if you could briefly answer that, and then Sheena, maybe we could get your thoughts. I don't know how much pre-service training is happening, but maybe each of you could briefly respond to that.
Sure, so if I can start. There are content. So one of the things that I think one of the following questions asked us was how much of it is sustainable and how much of it is actually done after the program is over. There are a lot of development partners who are actually working with this kind of educational material development and teachers training. So when we actually visited one of the teachers from the teachers training college, he said that we have materials, but because it is not part of the curriculum, they're not taught. So they have the materials, they've received the training for one of the projects. And when the project ended, the training also ended along with them. And one of the things that we fail to understand that this is a continuous process. There are continuously teachers, new teachers coming in, old teachers going out, and the teachers are, they resurface again. So it's not a one-time intervention that you can provide to the teachers and then assume that they will receive this or they will actually implement this in a larger scale. So it is one of those issues that we've tried to incorporate this into the, so we have actually received this response from teachers a lot that if you incorporate this, if you evaluate us on this, they will be part of the teacher's training curriculum. They will be part of the things we have to teach in school. And they will be just like math and biology that they were evaluated on. Their marks are important to the standard or the grading of the schools. And as part of this, the grading system, we will have to teach the menstrual hygiene and the puberty aspect and the practical menstrual hygiene practices. Also, if I can add one of the things is, I think it's one of the discussions that keeps on coming up. The characteristics of the teachers are very important in ensuring that these materials go to the students in the right way. So we focus a lot on the personality of the teachers on, for example, even if it's just a chemistry, But the way the teacher teaches is so important that it's not just the formula of the chemistry, but the interest in chemistry and the application in real life. Just like that, I think it's even more so important that the teacher is compassionate and can speak the languages of the students, or the boys and the girls, in getting this message across. So I hope I could answer that question.
Wonderful. Yeah, and you also spoke to a question we had around from Arundhati about the education sector and other partners and sort of the engagement. So maybe Sheena, over to you for one or both of those questions.
Sure, thank you. So yes, echoing a lot of what Tishana said, the way that we've structured a lot of the education initiatives has been through either private schools or charter schools to develop models, which then we can show how to replicate to the public sector. Because I think that's the difference between public sector programming is that you have to think about the entire set of public schools as one whole in many cases, whereas with private schools and other kinds of schools, it can be tailored a lot more to the kinds of needs that that school has or the resources that they have. And one of the biggest challenges that we've had with public sector is that, teachers and administrators and decision makers don't want girls and boys to have this education together. And that's just being placed in a conservative environment. And, you know, we've really advocated for the need for both girls and boys to receive information about each other's bodies, but it's something that makes pupils, parents, teachers very uncomfortable. And so a lot of what we have had to do is use opportunities in other kinds of programming that's happening. For example, WASH programs and other development kind of programs to integrate some of that menstrual health content. And so it's been really difficult to mainstream it in the public sector. So one of the things that we've tried to do is to at least have the content placed into the teacher training, not necessarily to be replicated in the classroom, but that teachers at least get some of that information. So then schools can progress in trying to figure out where the best placement of that information is. But unless they're sensitized and they don't have, you know, the background that we want them to, we have no hope really of getting it into public sector. And kind of speaking to the other question that was raised as well, one of the important aspects of that is trying to create greater intersectionality between departments. So we've tried to bring in the health department into this conversation, because with education, a lot of the conversation is often around, you know, girls dropping out of schools or missing school days, etc. But with health, it's a completely different set of conversations that are happening and their interest line in different areas of what's happening with menstrual health and what other, you know, aspects, including things like infection rates, etc. So trying to bring both of those players in has been key, I think, to giving it more attention and trying to get the resources allocated, because that's also a big part of sustainability.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that. I'm actually going to take another question and I'm going to pose it to Antar, but I don't know. I know that oftentimes UNGAI is circulating in the world of donors and governments. And one question came in about sort of how do we make these resources for teachers sustainable? How do we do this puberty work at a level that continues? And I'm not expecting you to have the magic answer to that, but that are ways that you hear about in the circles that UNGAI advocates around how do we promote this? What are the challenges? Are there, you know, entry points? So I don't know if you have any thoughts on sort of how one does that in a given country or at the global level.
Thanks so much, Marnie. Yeah, I think it has to go back to human rights, which is not just about teaching children human rights, but seeing the teachers as human beings and recognizing the systems that they operate in. For example, in the story I told you, only one out of 15 teachers was a woman. And by the way, the government makes no provision for her to work in a remote area. She doesn't get extra pay for working there. She doesn't have access to separate housing. And she is also operating under very regressive norms. So her family saying, why are you living out there alone in the village in the desert with 14 men? And when are you going to get married? And when are you going to have children? And by the way, when she does, she's no longer going to work there because her husband won't be okay with living there. So I think what we always try to do with donors is to say, yes, you want to put $3 billion into building toilets. That's fantastic. Please build toilets. Children need toilets. But look at what's happening in schools where there's toilet graveyards. This is a universal phenomenon. You go to a rural government school anywhere in the world, and you will find a shed that is no longer being used that used to be a toilet. And in some cases, in Rajasthan especially, which is a water scarce state, there's three generations of unused toilets. So what went wrong? They were just told, here's the money, go build a toilet. We have to show the donors we use the money, or we have to show the government we use the money. So they build a toilet. They didn't look at what is it going to take to make the toilet operate. In that case, it requires salary for a cleaner. It requires making sure that the water works. It requires making sure that there's windows and doors. Similarly, when there are programs that are just, or governments, you know, they want to give out pads because it's great social capital. It's a good way to get votes to say we're giving out pads. We should be the ones to always urge a more holistic approach. This child needs to learn many things. Menstruation is one of them. And puberty is the onset of many rights issues. And that needs to be a holistic measure. This woman teacher needs a lot of support to keep doing her job. And by the way, we really need her to keep doing her job, because her being there means girls are going to stay in school. And as evidence is showing, boys are actually even going to be learning better as well. So I think it comes down to looking at what that child needs, what that woman teacher needs, and being more holistic in that approach. So to what extent can we use those billions of dollars for pads and toilets? Put it back on the government to provide tax-free products, you know, subsidized products, and use it to support these women teachers.
Wonderful. And it's almost as if you read John Valdez's comment in the chat box, which is teachers menstruate too. They need toilets, they need facilities, but absolutely, as many of you know, toilets are one of my favorite topics. They need to be designed well and right if they're going to be used. Otherwise, it is not a good use of funds. So I thank you so much for bringing that up. And I see that Tishan is busy answering the question about how do we help male teachers to understand their roles, which I think is a key one. Before I go to that, I just wanted to come back to Fran, and I'm going to, I'm not sure what your thoughts are, but I'm just going to pop this question to you. What are the challenges, and this I think is true for puberty and menstrual health education as well, although I do think there's good ways. There was a question around how do you integrate, or the challenges of integrating student perspectives into curriculum development or content you might want to teach in school. So from your sort of global perspective of education and curriculum, how have you seen that done well, or what are your sort of thoughts on that?
Yeah, great question. This can be a big challenge. And I think one of the reasons for that is that students' perspectives and students' knowledge is not necessarily considered authoritative knowledge the way teachers' knowledge or textbook knowledge is. But when we're thinking about students as those who come up with strategies for effectively dealing with some of the challenges of menstruation, they should absolutely have a voice here. So some areas around the world where this is being addressed is through, you know, youth empowerment movements and youth organizations that are able to speak with a collective voice and make their priorities known, send representatives to national conventions, convening bodies where policies are being made. Not all governments respect this. Not all teachers are comfortable with this. But I think that in teacher training programs, this is another place for us to help future teachers, especially, you know, young teachers who were not so long ago high school students themselves, think about the value of youth perspectives on the curriculum and on ways of best managing menstrual health. So I would see that, you know, collective organizations, youth organizations as one area, and helping future teachers as well as in-service teachers, but particularly pre-service teachers, appreciate the knowledge that students create and that they bring with them to the classroom.
Wonderful. So great response. I'm aware of the time, and I just want to speak briefly to some of the other great questions in here. There are questions from John Valdez asking about how we convey this information to those with disabilities. You know, if folks have answers to that, if you have links to that, feel free to put that into the chat. I know there's a global, I was just at a meeting that UNESCO held, which I think is speaks to another question, which is how do we ensure educational content is correct globally? And UNESCO is, I think, soon going to launch an effort that really pushes for, that includes puberty education for those who are 5 to 12. And really, what are the key learnings for that age group? Perhaps a little bit separate from comprehensive sexuality education, focusing in on what does that age group need. The challenge that surfaced at the meeting was there are so many topics. And I think everybody at the meeting was reflecting the concern about the burden on teachers that you all have raised today, and what can we really expect and ask countries and teachers to do. So I'm hoping that when that push comes out, there is some additional content. UNESCO, almost a decade ago, I think, released a policy document on global puberty education. It's translated into a few languages. It never got a lot of press, but it is out there. So if folks want to see that policy document, which really was a review of puberty education, it may be a bit overwhelming, but my team can try to find it and make that link available to anyone who sends us an email. So I want to make sure that we, and then just very quickly, Carla, I see your question about menopause. I'm going to guess the programs have not been integrating menopause because we haven't yet even integrated basic what is your period. Although I love that question, and we're hoping to do some work on that ourselves. And then lastly, just to speak to the questions coming from the United States around the challenges politically we are facing here in some states where they are banning or trying to ban education for young people about periods, and very disturbing. One of the things that I think has been interesting that we learned from Sierra Leone was the benefit of something simple like a puberty book, although books are even being banned in some parts of America. So we won't talk about that today. But there are ways, I think, to reach young people, whether you're able to do it in the classroom or not. And so I think we may have to get creative here in America for a little while, but I hope it's not permanent. I hope this is a phase. I want to just sort of have a few final slides. So if the our speakers could close their videos again, just for a few minutes, but maybe keep your eye on the chat box and the Q&A box, because you're still getting some. We did our Q&A. What I wanted to just sort of wrap up along with a tremendous thanks for what was, I think, a fantastic set of speakers and reflections for this final webinar of our season. Please remember for our future webinars, as I said at the beginning, we're going to take a break for a couple months over the summer months here in New York. And then we will pick up again in September with our fifth year of Period Posse Presents webinars, which is just amazing to me. But if you just happen to sign up for this one and want to make sure that you get invitations to all the new ones that will come up, or to get the recordings for the past ones when you miss one, please be sure to sign up for the series. We also want your ideas. We keep a running list of ideas and speakers for future topics. We like to really get new ideas and showcase people from around the world. So please do email Susie. I'm about to show her email, or me. And please do share with your networks. I love seeing some of you introduce yourselves in the chat box. As I said once or twice, we really want you to use this platform as a way to find each other, to connect, and to potentially work together or do projects together going forward. This is a wrap on season 4. Thank you for engaging, for participating. And I want to just, before I finish, say just an enormous thanks to Susie Martinez, who's quietly behind the scenes, doing just fantastic work, making sure. Actually, Susie, could you turn on your video for a minute and just wave at everybody? I just want to make sure everybody sees you there. You know, she does just a huge amount of work behind the scenes, making sure that the webinar runs smoothly, that we have all of our slides ready to go, and that we have our speakers all lined up. So thank you again, all of you. for joining us today. Thank you again, our phenomenal speakers. We look forward to seeing you in a couple months when we start up again. And the webinar recording hopefully will come out in about a week. We will send it off to the school. It takes them a little time to get it posted, but Susie will be sending out the recording, and also to this listserv, you'll be receiving a reminder about the MOOC and the scholarship for the MOOC. So please do share that widely with your networks. We're really hoping that people take advantage of that. Either just take the free course for folks who don't know about it, or if you do want to get a certificate and the price that edX charges is too much, please make sure to apply. We are privileging applicants from low and middle income countries for those scholarships. And please share that widely. So thanks everyone again. I'm going to stop talking. Have a wonderful day or nighttime wherever you are in the world.